Good morning. I don't know what I can do after my previous speaker, but I thought maybe this will help. Or this, 2, 3 smiles, maybe a few more, 10, 20. I was very lucky this year to have 130,000 smiles for Katha from children we were working with. I started the organization Katha nearly 25 years ago, in 1988. When I started, I wanted to make lovely books for children. I thought I'll just fill their lives with happiness and joy and big smiles and have lovely illustrations, lovely stories. I took my first book into a slum and found the school that had children in it. And there were 4-year-olds sitting over there making paper envelopes. I was told that they had to make a certain number of envelopes before they would get their lunch. The mothers didn't know this was happening, but I was first frustrated, dismayed, angry, and then outraged. I said, we can't be doing these things to our children. But what could I do? I mean, there was I, a single person. I had just come from Chennai, which is deep south, and I'm sitting in Delhi. I don't even know the language properly. And what am I going to do for children in Delhi? So there was a lot of thinking, a lot of moving around. There was a lot of, you know, agonizing. Agonizing for the last 25 years has been my most favorite word. I agonize over every single thing, it seems like. So then when the solution came, it was not easy. Because I had gone into the slums and I asked the women, why are you not sending your children to the Katha school? I had only 5 children. I wanted 50. I couldn't get 50. And there were a lakh and 50,000, 150,000 people living in this huge slum, the biggest slum in the world, in Delhi. And the mother said, yes, I think it's a very good idea for children to go to school, but how can they? They are supporting me. Most of the homes were women-headed households, and the men were there, but not always available for the family. And the women had children who had to go out and work and bring money home. The average family income was about 600 to 800 rupees, which is about £8, I think, a month. So I thought, if I can get £8 into the hands of the woman, then I can get the children to school. Then I have the moral right, actually, to go and tell the women, please send your children to school. Because what was the point in making books and saying that I wanted to enhance the joy of reading if children couldn't read? I had to get them to read first. I had to have a school, and I have to sort of bring them in and teach them how to read. So the whole idea was to go there and get them in, and then to get the women in, get all my friends in, and teach them. So we were teaching them how to do macrame and quilted jackets and cakes. We were teaching them how to make black forest cake when they didn't even know what black was or forest was. Anyway, that it was something geographical out there, I think. I don't know. So we are there trying to work with the women. And the solution when it came was impossible. I didn't think we could do it. We had to first get the communities out of poverty. We had to get the women to be more self-empowered. We had to get the children into school, and we had to teach them well, which means that we had to have good teachers. And we had to have good material for them to read and to enjoy. I wanted just quality for children. I thought if I could have this big queue over there, and children could get in, and they could get the quality of education that every child deserves, and not just merely the education their parents could afford, I thought maybe we were doing the trick, and maybe we could do it. So the whole idea of getting the children in and getting the women in, training the women, training the teachers, so all these things happening at the same time, well, it was not worth doing it at all. Today, I'm not going to talk about the women. They started off at this £8 for the whole family, all the family members working. Today, we've trained 140,000 women in Katha, and the women are earning 10 times what they were earning when we started. And our students, we've had so many students who've come into the school. It didn't stay with 5. We went up to 1,600, and then we come down to 1,300. We have 21 schools across Delhi and across Haryana and In Arunachal Pradesh, we work with the tribal people. We've been working with street children. And the children are doing so well. They are in the top 10 percentile age wage earners in the country today. It's not much, 10,000 rupees. But the thing is that they are in the top 10. And we said it's possible. And what made it possible? It was a story school. We said it would be story that would make the whole thing work. The story as a way of teaching not just language, not just literature, not just saying that this is literacy for children so that they could come, learn something and go away. But it was teaching them maths and science and geography and history and sociology and earth sciences. We were looking at children learning nanotechnology. We were teaching them Mach numbers. We were teaching them, this year we are going to be looking at marine biology for our children. They're all children in the slums. They are children who only speak in Hindi. Our teachers only speak in Hindi. But the fact is that they have creativity and they are gritty. They know that they want it. And our women are there behind them. Their mothers are there behind them saying, you have to go, you have to do this. And they come and they do it. The story school became a reality. And what was it if we said to the teachers, you're not going to use textbooks? Because we said that textbooks did not work for our children. So we had some very, very strong rules for our teachers. It was lucky that they came from the slums themselves. They'd never been to a proper BEd school, so they didn't know that this is the only way to teach with textbooks. So they came in and we said, you work with illustrations like this. Or like this. This is coming from a tribal group, Mithila, in India. Or these. So these were some of the illustrations. And from this, the teachers were teaching maths and science and space studies and all kinds of things. We found, for instance, that children, by the time we came to 2004, 2005, children were becoming creative themselves. They were saying that we can go out and do things, and the curriculum was giving them the space to do it. So we started off that year by saying, let's go and find out what's happening in the slum. Are women having the freedom that they have, they need to have? Are they safe? And so the children went and did a survey over there. Are children having enough playgrounds? What is a low income in the slum? What is a low income in the city? They went out, they did these surveys, and they came back and they fed them into these computers. 2005, we had got our first computer which had been donated to us. Our teachers refused to work on them because they thought it will go boom and it will all break and they would not be able to touch them at all. But the children were not scared. They said, oh, what is this? Oh, this is the mouse and this is the computer and what is this? Oh, okay, what do you want me to draw? And can you put an elephant over here? Yes, they were willing to put an elephant, put eyes onto the elephant. And a time came when they were helping the teachers to master the computer. They were the ones who were helping our women, because you remember, we were teaching our women to be tailors and, you know, doing embroidery and, you know, cooking and baking. So the children were helping them to find good recipes. They were helping them to find good designs. They were saying, okay, this is what's available in a boutique, and so maybe you can make a kurta like this. So the children were helping to find all these things for our women. And more. You see, we had a system by which we said that men had to come into the school, and the women had to come in, and the men never came in. We didn't even know. We were all breaking our heads over how to get the men into the school because it was important for them to come in and be with us. And then we said, maybe a shopkeeper's guild because the men were all keeping shops. So we started a shopkeeper's guild. And we told them, if you come into the school, our children will help you to make better profits. And they did. They came into our school. They worked on our computers. And now they have their own shopkeeper's guild. And it's the children who've been helping them. Being a reader is not always just being a reader. It's not just reading for fun. It is good if children can read for fun, and we think we need to start with children reading for fun. But more than that, we need to have children reading for meaning. And that's what the Katha School was trying to do. We found, for instance, when at a time when the sewage water was backing up into our slums, the children had the robotics, they had the Legos with them, and they made a little plunger, and they said that this is going to work like a submarine, and it's going to have a submarine thing. It will go into this little, the sewage lines, and it'll locate where the block is, and then we'll use the plunger, and we will get the block away. They've been doing some amazing things with computers. They've been doing amazing things with the Lego blocks that they have. And we found that by the time they had come to a point when they could understand that their world was theirs to make sustainable. It was they who had to take responsibility for their world. And they could. We took a challenge in 2001 saying no Katha child will live in poverty. By 2008, we were finding that our children were earning and the women were earning and the slums, the 122 slums we were working in, were coming out of poverty. And then last year, the children, when we had to spread into more and more slums, and we found that Delhi has about 1,700 slums, when we were spreading and we said we don't have the money and we don't have the people, we don't know how to go about it, we had the children. They were little ones. We had ones, 8-year-olds and 9-year-olds and 10-year-olds and 15-year-olds who came and said, we can take charge. We've been here and we can do it. So 1,500 of them were our volunteers. They were our teachers. They went out into the slums and they saw to it that the children were reading at grade level. And in 2008, when the government came to us and they said, do you think you can bring the Katha school into our government system? We said, we'll try, and we went into the government system. And now, government is saying, why don't you scale it up? And why don't you mainstream? We would like to mainstream the innovation. It seems like something that is very, very simple, like a story, which could enhance the joy of reading, could actually make a change in the lives of children, in the lives of people, in the lives of a whole nation. And we think that as we move on, we came to this amazing number. We started with 5, and then now we've touched around more than 3 million, nearly 4 million children who've come into the Katha schools, into our centers. We worked with street children. We've tried very, very hard to understand, is there something called a nomadic brain? Is that why they run away from the school? They run and hide behind every bush and every, you know, bridge that they can find. And we have found that it is possible to crack not just a physics or a chemistry or an IT puzzle. It's possible to crack a human puzzle. And I just want to go back and remember when I was a very small child. And we had to find the third crescent, which was a little moon. It's a little pairing of a moon that would appear in the sky after the new moon. Very difficult to find in a sky of stars. But my grandmother would say, you must find the moon before you can sit down and have your supper. So there would we be, all the uncles and aunts and this huge joint family, searching the sky. And then one of us would point out, there is the moon. And my grandmother comes out and she looks and, where is the moon? She can't find it. It was then that we learned that the journey between the tip of your finger and the stars is yours and yours alone. Nobody can take it with you. You have to take it on your own. Our children took it. And I'm sure all of you are just waiting to take the leap. And I hope when you take the leap, you'll take the little child inside you. Thank you.